Good morning and welcome to St. John's. We've partnered today with Faith and Public Life and Feminary to bring you a naloxone save service. Tomorrow is International Overdose Awareness Day, and so that is the reason we're lifting that up today. So whoever you are and wherever you are on life's journey, you are always welcome here. Naloxone save service. I just want to begin by saying that this service has an aching timeliness today, as just this morning, the harm reduction community in Columbus is once again reeling from the loss of one of their own. We got word this morning that Dylan Stanley, a local harm reduction leader, died yesterday morning. Dylan was a mother, a friend, and a champion. She fought hard for her life and has saved the lives of countless others. We are grieving her today, and this service is dedicated in her honor. Our guest preacher, Blythe Barno, couldn't be with us in person today because of COVID and recorded her sermon before hearing the news. The sermon's themes of loving people who use drugs and combating anti-blackness hits close to home with Dylan's death. This time last year, Dylan helped to lead a service just like this one at Church for All People just down the road. So for her leadership, we say thank you, Dylan. Dylan, know now and always that you are loved unconditionally. Here at St. John's, we always begin our services by passing the peace. There's scripture that says this is peace that passes understanding, that even when the chaos in us and around us doesn't foster peace, that we can share the peace of God. So I invite you into that space with us this morning. So may the peace of God be with you. And please share peace online with one another in the Facebook Live comments and in the room in a socially distanced way. Please join me in the call to worship. A prayer for those we have lost to overdose and the war on drugs, written by Blythe Barno. My love, my sibling, my parent, my friend, family, you are family to me. Your perfection is not required, it never was, not to love you, not to grieve you. You are and have always been worthy. We know the truth of you, your love, your contradictions, your challenge. We know your laughter and hurt and hope. We carry you with us even now. So today we call you by your name. It is beloved. Today we allow ourselves to love you fully. Today we allow ourselves to grieve you honestly. We miss you. And we know that your life was a life worth saving. No matter your choices or your struggle, we miss you, because grief is born of knowing. May your memory be a flame for the way forward, compelling us to act as agents of resurrection, proclaiming loudly that every life is worth saving, and all loss is worthy of our grief. Amen.
God, A reading from the book of Exodus, the third chapter. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a bush. He looked, and the bush was blazing, yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, "I must turn aside and look at this great sight and see why the bush is not burned up." When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, "Moses, Moses." And he said, "Here I am." Then God said, "Come no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground." God said further, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, "I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me. I have also seen how the Egyptians oppress them. So come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt." But Moses said to God, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" He said, "I will be with you, and this shall be the sign for you that it is I who sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this mountain." But Moses said to God, "If I come to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your ancestors has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name?' what shall I say to them?" God said to Moses, "I am who I am." God said further, "Thus you shall say to the Israelites, 'I am has sent me to you.'" God also said to Moses, "Thus you shall say to the Israelites, 'The Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this my title for all generations.'" Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
Today I'm reading our gospel reading on behalf of Blythe Barno, who will be with us remotely today. I invite you all to continue to share your love online for the music, for the message, for the guests who are here today. I offer this scripture on behalf of all of the harm reduction specialists and advocates who are working hard to create more compassionate communities. The scripture for today is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 10, verses 5 through 8. And Matthew writes this: "These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: 'Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news: the kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment.'" Here ends the reading. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. And as Mary comes forward for the children's moment, I just want to mention something to you. Today, and on many Sundays, I read scripture out of my study Bible, which is now held together with tape that my husband gave me because it's so used and it has so many notes in it. It's so written in that the binding has broken. I saw a study that said that right now people are reading scripture less. Perhaps it's because of the pandemic. Perhaps it's because of social unrest. Perhaps it's because of lots of things. But I encourage you, if you don't have your own Bible, if you don't have a study Bible, let us know and we will provide one for you, because we use this as a basis for our faith. It has given us some really good instructions for the last 2,000 years. It's also caused a lot of consternation, and we invite you, if you don't have a Bible, to let us know and we will get one to you so you can join with us in reading the scripture each and every week. And some of our seminarians, like Hank, will let you know that all of this is also available now free online. If you Google Bible, get the New Revised Standard Version. It's the version that we use most frequently when we're reading scripture. Thank you.
Well, good morning. How's everyone doing? It's good to see you on Facebook and with us in the sanctuary. I am working this week on a bulletin board as we get ready to welcome new members. I needed some people. See my fun people on my bulletin board. So I need 12. So let's see. Why don't you count with me and help me count and see how many we have. We have 1, 2, 3. Yeah, that one doesn't count. 4, 5. Nah, that one doesn't count. 6, 7, 8. That one doesn't count. No, that one doesn't count. 8, 9. So I'm short a few, except I have this doesn't count pile, which is interesting because today we are talking about people who use drugs and how we can save the lives when people use too many drugs. And so the message is fairly simple. The message is that everyone counts. Everyone's life is worthy. Everyone's life is worth saving. And everyone counts. So we'll put them all back in the basket. And even in the light of the loss of our friend Dylan, we are reminded that everyone counts. We are in a time in our country where we're counting people. It is census time. And parents and grown-ups, if you have children in your lives, if you haven't done the census yet, I encourage you to get online and do that. It's census.gov, easy enough. It's about 2 or 3 minutes long, and there are questions that children can help you answer. So help them kind of be a part of their democracy as we determine where money and resources go for the next decade. Because everyone counts. Let's pray. 1, 2, 3. Dear God, help us remember that everyone's life is worth saving, that everyone is worthy of love, and that everybody counts. In Jesus' name, amen.
salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? I will wait on you. Trust in your goodness, and in your goodness, Lord. I will trust, I will wait, and I will trust on you, God. You are my song, you are my salvation. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid?
I was 20 on the day of Kachi's funeral. It was in a large church in Northeast Ohio. A week earlier, he had overdosed in a motel room on heroin and crack. He died a few days later in a local hospital. He was one of my first big loves. We sat quiet and still in that church, and the pastor's words echoed through us when he softly lamented just how easily Kachi could have avoided going to hell. It echoed through us when he condemned us to the same fate. And what that pastor did that day, it was not the work of the gospel. Shame can never be the work of the gospel because it's death-dealing and not life-giving. Easter may be far from us on the calendar, but it's my favorite holiday and the foundation of my faith. I love it because it reminds me to honor and celebrate the simple and profound ways that people resurrect their lives every day. People change. They come back from the brink. They strive to bring their communities back to life. Easter reminds us that even when our families, our communities, and yes, sometimes our churches, seal the tomb and pronounce us dead to them, that we can still rise. Every day, people defy the destructive forces of the world by choosing dignity, grace, and connection. And it's so very worthy of our celebration. And I think it's what that pastor forgot that day, what too many of us have forgotten, that Christians are called to be an Easter people, a resurrection people. As longtime harm reductionist Marilyn Reyes says, we are meant to speak life into people, not death. When I think of resurrection, I think of my friend Dave. We had plans one day, but he never showed up, which happens sometimes. A week later, he told me that he'd overdosed that day. He died. He'd been sober for a few months and decided to use one more time, and because his tolerance was low, it killed him. Luckily, his mom came home unexpectedly, and he was able to be revived with naloxone, but he'd been dead, and now he's alive. Real life resurrection. Naloxone, which is also sometimes called Narcan, is a medication that blocks the effects of opiates like Oxycontin, heroin, fentanyl, and carfentanil. Its ability to block opiates means that it can be used to stop or reverse an opiate overdose. It saves lives. In 2019, about 72,000 people died of a fatal overdose in this country, and 4,000 of them were Ohioans. Unfortunately, these numbers are only growing this year. In fact, here in Franklin County, the coroner says that fatalities have increased about 55% during the first quarter of 2020 alone. Many are quick to attribute this increase solely to the pandemic, but we know that it's more than that. What's worse is that we know that some of these deaths were preventable, a grief that is sometimes too heavy to bear. Harm reduction is a set of practical strategies and ideas aimed at minimizing the negative health, social, and legal impacts associated with drug use and drug laws. It focuses on supporting holistic, positive change and on supporting people without judgment, coercion, discrimination, or without requiring that they stop using drugs as a precondition of our support. Simply put, it's meeting people where they're at and supporting them in keeping themselves as safe, healthy, and connected as possible without the condition of their sobriety. Harm reduction redefines recovery as any positive change because we understand that change is a process. So if you use a little less, that's an act of recovery. If you use sterile equipment, that's an act of recovery. If you wait to pick up until after the rent's paid, that's an act of recovery. And if you're completely abstinent, that's also an act of recovery. Theologically put, it is the recognition of what is divine within yourself and others. It's an expression of the unconditional love of God, the love of neighbor, the work of the gospel. Last year, across the country, grassroots harm reduction advocates distributed over 1 million doses of naloxone. Collectively, they've helped save countless lives. And those lives were not saved by paramedics or police or health departments. They were saved by people who use drugs. When given easy access to naloxone, the vast majority of overdose reversals are completed by people who use drugs because they are the true first responders in this overdose crisis. Community naloxone distribution in the U.S. was started in the 90s by a man named Dan Bigg. He ran the Chicago Recovery Alliance alongside other people who use drugs. And he saw no reason why this medication that had been used in the hospital since the 70s could not also be used in the community. His work, which I would call a ministry, is profound and far-reaching. This life-saving work that we often associate with police or health departments was actually developed first by people who use drugs. This is important. Naloxone distribution, fentanyl testing strips, syringe access. These are all interventions that were created by people who use drugs in order to save and improve one another's lives. Because contrary to what we're often told, people who use drugs value their lives and the lives of their community. As Christians, we know something about how outcasts can save us, about how outcasts can change the world. But more than that, we know that God doesn't make outcasts. We do. And that to be a Christian means to reject any system that tells us that some of God's children are less worthy of love, community, and connection. The founders of harm reduction understood that to truly reduce harm, we must address the systemic harms that are trickling down into individual lives. We must shift power and resources to those who are most in need and who know the most from lived experience. People who use drugs are the leaders of our work to end overdose, so we ought not villainize, but instead listen and learn. After all, it sounds a lot like the gospel to me. Ohio has not yet learned from Dan Biggs' example or his generosity. Ohio's the only state that still lists naloxone as a dangerous drug and requires you to obtain a tedious and costly license in order to distribute it, severely limiting our community distribution. Licking County, next door to us, has banned syringe access. Even though the Center for Disease Control tells us that syringe access programs drastically reduce new HIV and hepatitis C infections, and that new users of syringe access programs are 5 times more likely to enter drug treatment and 3 times more likely to stop using drugs altogether. Ohio's Good Samaritan Law, which is meant to protect those possessing minor amounts of drugs from prosecution if they call for help when somebody overdoses, excludes those who need it the most, those who are on parole or probation. And it doesn't allow you to receive that protection more than twice, even though we know there are people in our communities reversing more than 2 overdoses in a day. This leaves people to fear for their lives and their freedom when they need help the most. This is why Ohio regularly has the 2nd or 3rd highest overdose death rate in the country. Ohioans do not use drugs more than people in other states, and we're not uniquely targeted by fentanyl. We simply aren't adequately equipping people with the tools they need to survive. As the church, we must recognize that we had a role in creating this crisis, and we have a role in ending it. People who use drugs have been doing the gospel work that the church has been avoiding. They've been preaching resurrection, and we're missing it. Worse than that, often we're making it harder. We make it harder when we attach shame, stigma, and sin to drug use. We make it harder when we treat people who use drugs like the other instead of as a fellow child of God, whether they're living in the streets or sitting in the pew beside us. We make it harder when we allow people to wield the word addict like a weapon, essentializing someone down to just one part of who they are, defining them by their struggle, and marking them as separate. As people of faith, we must confront and combat the shame, stigma, and judgment in our own hearts, pulpits, and congregations. We must also lobby legislators for the common sense policies we need to save our communities, like House Bill 205 locally, which would expand our Good Samaritan policy in Ohio, and the BREATHE Act federally. We must push back against efforts to further criminalize people who use drugs and who sell drugs, which too often is simply just code for people of color and poor people. We must take bold moral action and support efforts to defund the police. As Christians, we are called to cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers of our own making, and cast out the demons of shame and stigma. So we must commit to lifting people up when systems let them fall, and intervening when systems would just let people die. Growing up in a white working class town in Northeast Ohio, I watched as my friends feverishly worked to obtain the American dream, a dream that felt promised to us even if not consciously, largely because we were white. As white people, we were told that this country works for us. So when we couldn't pull ourselves out of the struggle and poverty that shaped our day-to-day, we didn't think that the system failed us. We thought we failed ourselves. And I watched as that feeling of failure, which is rooted in white supremacy, tricked people I love into believing that they were unworthy, a pain they sought to ease with substance use, which without access to harm reduction information, ultimately claimed many of their lives. We live in a time where white youth, are being leveraged against communities of color, just as white women were in the civil rights era. A desire to protect the virtue, purity, and abstinence of white youth is fueling the violent policing and mass incarceration of people of color, as well as dehumanizing immigration policy at our borders. The subtext always being that people of color are responsible for the production and sale of drugs and are therefore a threat to innocent white children. Some of us might be familiar with the war on drugs. Maybe it conjures up images of eggs in frying pans or the phrase, just say no. What most of us don't know is that the war on drugs dates back to the 1930s and beyond, and began as a racist attack on Black and immigrant communities. The first anti-opium laws in the 1870s were an attack on Chinese migrants after white men feared losing their jobs on the railroad. Black men in the South were the target of the first anti-cocaine laws in the early 1900s, and Mexican migrants and Mexican Americans were the targets of the first anti-marijuana laws in the 1910s and 20s. In fact, that's why we use the word marijuana in this country instead of cannabis, because it sounded more Mexican and supported the criminalization of Mexican migrants as drug dealers and criminals. And we can hear these same attacks continue today when Donald Trump speaks about law and order or demands that we defend our borders. The original architect of the war on drugs was a man named Harry Anslinger. He was the first commissioner of the Federal Bureau of Narcotics and a widely known white supremacist. Targeting communities of color, especially Black Americans, with drug charges and harassment was part of Anslinger's strategy to justify the existence and budget of the Federal Bureau of Narcotics. In fact, Anslinger targeted famous singer Billie Holiday for her song Strange Fruit, which protested the lynching of Black Americans. Anslinger demanded she stop performing the song, and when she refused, he retaliated by regularly arresting her on drug charges and placing her under surveillance for decades, even going so far as raiding her hospital room and handcuffing her to the hospital bed as she lay dying. To be clear, Billie Holiday was not put under surveillance because her drug use was a threat, but she was put under surveillance because she dared to resist white supremacy. This racist drug war continues to target Black communities. We can see it in the murder of Breonna Taylor, who was killed in her bed by police who were executing a no-knock warrant on suspected drug charges. We can see it when the police officer who murdered George Floyd looked casually around and said, "This is why you don't do drugs, kids." In 1971, President Nixon formally declared the war on drugs. John Ehrlichman, one of Nixon's top advisors, recently offered a candid reflection on the foundation of this so-called war. He said, and I quote, "The Nixon campaign in 1968 and the Nixon White House after that had two enemies, the anti-war left and Black people. You understand what I'm saying. We knew we couldn't make it illegal to be either against the war or Black, but by getting the public to associate the hippies with marijuana and Blacks with heroin, and then criminalizing both heavily, we could disrupt those communities. We could arrest their leaders, raid their homes, break up their meetings, and vilify them night after night on the evening news. Did we know we were lying about the drugs? Of course we did," he concluded. Criminalization, racism, and white supremacy are the foundations of our drug policy. And every year, it costs Americans, particularly Black Americans, their lives and their freedom. We can see it here in Ohio. White people are more likely to sell drugs and all races use drugs at similar rates, but the highest increase of overdose deaths in Ohio are among Black men, and 43% of incarcerated Ohioans are Black. Racism and white supremacy fuels our understanding of drug use, which fuels policing, which fuels mass incarceration, which fuels overdose death. When the movement for Black lives demands that we defund the police, they are asking, in part, for an end to this war. A war whose purpose and budget was grown out of anti-Blackness, coercion, and violence. The movement for Black lives is a harm reduction movement. After all, like we said, harm reduction is about more than reducing risk. As Monique Tula, executive director of the National Harm Reduction Coalition, says, harm reduction is a movement, one that shifts resources and power to the people who are most vulnerable to structural violence. As people of faith, we know that budgets are moral documents. And when the city of Columbus spends a third of its budget on policing, we are saying that God values systems of punishment and surveillance over systems of care and connection. But in the UCC, we commit to being in covenant with one another and with the world, which means we commit to caring for one another and remaining in right relationship. But violent policing ruptures that covenant, both by harming us and our siblings in Christ, but also by leaving us with the false impression that the hurt and harm in our communities is no longer our responsibility, but instead can be simply handled by just calling the police. Overinvestment in policing only allows suspicion and fear of one another to grow. Instead, the movement for Black lives is asking us to deepen our moral imagination and ask what God really wants for us. Does God want no-knock warrants? Or does God want neighbors and neighborhoods made safe by abundance? Made safe through enough food to eat, enough homes in which to sleep, enough money for rent and leisure, enough helping hands. The movement for Black lives is asking us to defund the police and invest in Black communities so that we can truly make our budgets match our morals, because we know that God wants all of us to have life and have it abundantly. The movement for Black lives is reminding us that when we reject fear and white supremacy, we all have enough. For this, many are calling the movement dangerous. For this, many are trying to cast them as political outcasts. But as Christians, we know something about how outcasts can save us and about how outcasts can change the world. Some of you may be thinking, I thought we were just talking about ending overdose today. Let me assure you, we are. After all, when Kachi began to overdose in that hotel room 15 years ago, it was racist drug policy that kept the person who was with him from calling for help, afraid that they would both be incarcerated instead of helped. Because Black lives didn't matter, his life didn't matter. A legacy of anti-Blackness an anti-immigrant policy left 72,000 people to die a preventable death last year. So in honor of Overdose Awareness Day, I'm going to ask you to do two things. To believe in resurrection by learning to reverse an overdose and getting your own naloxone kit. And to honor our commitment to covenant by looking up the Breathe Act, a federal bill introduced by the Movement for Black Lives, and calling your representatives and your senators and asking them to sign on as a co-sponsor. Because we know that naloxone saves, But it's not enough. To end overdose, we must end the war on drugs too. The movement for Black Lives, the harm reduction movement, these are Easter movements striving to bring our communities back to life. And as Christians, we are called to be an Easter people, a resurrection people. Both these movements require the tough work of reclaiming dignity. Both require us to engage our own healing. They ask us to have a systemic understanding of our deeply personal pain. They ask us to love ourselves and each other more deeply. It is truly the toughest form of love because it requires the transformation of all of us. It's messy, and it's so very worth it. As followers of the gospel, we must speak life into people. So let us say loudly that Black lives matter to God and matter to us. And let us name clearly that the children of God deserve better than the war on drugs. May we remember that the power of resurrection lives within us, in our hearts, in our hands. We need only choose it. We need only claim our legacy as an Easter people in this Good Friday world.
Well, we thank you for your time and attention to this important issue. And in a moment, we will move into our offering. And I'm here to say that I'm pleased to be part of a church that has already been involved in harm reduction efforts. As of last year, for example, we had a partnership with the Columbus Department of Health, and they came and did a distribution of the testing strips and the free naloxone kits and other things. So this has been part of St. John's work. This is not new for us, but we are awfully pleased today to have Blythe with us remotely and to have Pastor Dan's leadership. And again, bringing this issue to our attention during the pandemic, there has been an uptick in overdoses during the pandemic, not due solely to the pandemic, as Blythe mentioned, but it is something that is deserving of our time and attention, especially tomorrow on International Overdose Awareness Day. So I want to thank you all for that. Let us know online if you have ever been involved in this issue. If you would like to learn more, our staff can follow up with your comments and send you more information if you will let us know online that you would like more information. Or you can contact the church office or Pastor Dan directly if you'd like to become more involved in this issue. As we move to our invitation to offering in this very special church that is part of the United Church of Christ and on the forefront of social justice issues, not behind the curve, we're ahead of the curve. The invitation to offering that was written for today says this: if we pay close enough attention, when we look around, all we can see is need. But is that how you think God sees us or sees it? I think that as God looks around, God sees need, yes, but God also sees great abundance. God sees all the gifts God has already given us, and God sees opportunity. As a church, we are invited to look around through the same lens, seeing opportunity, gifts, possibilities around us, while acknowledging the deep needs that surround us. Each person here has something to give, and each person has a need. I invite you to prayerfully reach within yourself, acknowledging a need you bring today, recognizing that every person around you brings a need as well. As a church, it is our calling to join together and meet those needs. Share them with us, share those needs with us, and we will receive them prayerfully. And as the offering is gathered, I invite you to acknowledge in your giving that you have a gift to share too. And I invite you to share that gift generously, trusting that the people around you will do the same. Share your gifts with us, and we will receive them gratefully Thanks be to God. Amen.
God can use me anywhere, Lord, anytime. I'm gonna live so God can use me anywhere, Lord, anytime. I'm gonna walk so God
Thank you for taking this training video and learning how to become an opioid overdose responder. If you have any questions about the content of this video or opioid overdose, don't hesitate to contact jamie@nextdistro.org or fill out the contact form on our website. Opioids are a class of drugs that relieve pain. Some people also take them to get high or keep from going into withdrawal. Opioids include prescription drugs such as Oxycontin, Vicodin, or Percocet, as well as drugs like heroin. Fentanyl is an opioid that is 50 to 100 times stronger than morphine and is leading to an increase in overdose deaths across the country. Fentanyl is being found not just in heroin, but in cocaine and counterfeit pills as well. An overdose occurs when someone takes more or stronger opioids than their body can manage. This can lead to dangerously slow breathing, and if the person doesn't get help, it could result in death. Some possible signs of an opioid overdose include being unconscious or passed out, slower or stopped breathing, lips or fingernails turning blue or gray depending on the person's skin tone, making snoring or gurgling sounds. If any of these symptoms are present, it's important to respond quickly. Check for responsiveness. Shake and shout at the person as if you're trying to wake them. If they don't respond, perform a sternal rub by making a fist and rubbing your knuckles hard along the person's sternum or breastbone. If they don't respond to this painful action, that means it's an emergency. You or someone else on the scene should call 911 immediately. It's important to know that help is on the way and also to have backup in case the person is having a different kind of emergency. The person who's overdosed may also need more naloxone than you have. In New York State, the Good Samaritan Law provides protection against charge and prosecution for drug possession to the individual who has called 911 to save a life, even if drugs are present. As soon as possible, administer Narcan, also known as naloxone. This is the antidote that reverses the effects of an opioid overdose. Peel the package back to remove the Narcan device, put your thumb on the bottom of the plunger and your first and middle fingers on either side of the nozzle. Put the nozzle in their nostril, press the plunger firmly to dispense the medication intranasally. Narcan can take 2 to 8 minutes to work, and sometimes more than one dose of naloxone is needed. Don't wait longer than a couple of minutes to give the second dose. In addition to calling for help and giving Narcan, provide rescue breaths. Getting oxygen to an overdosing person may reduce serious complications and keep the person alive until help arrives. If the person doesn't become responsive right away and if you're not performing rescue breathing, put them in the recovery position. This is really essential if you need to leave the person alone. Hopefully, after one or two doses of Narcan, the person will become responsive. If this happens, tell them what happened. Explain that they were overdosing and that you gave them Narcan. If the person uses opioids regularly, they may experience withdrawal until the Narcan wears off. Assure them that their withdrawal symptoms will pass. It's important to explain that Narcan only lasts between 30 and 90 minutes and that using more drugs could increase the chance of another overdose and furthermore is unlikely to ease the withdrawal symptoms. If for whatever reason the person didn't seek medical attention, stay with them for at least 3 hours to ensure they're all right and they don't need medical help. If you've used your Narcan, it's important to us that you fill out the reversal form located on this website. You can also get more Narcan mailed to you. Thank you for being a lifesaver. If you want to learn more about anything you learned here, our website has more information and links to our resources, fact sheets, and...
Thank you. We are grateful to our tech team here at St. John's for making it possible for us today to show you both Blythe's sermon as well as this special overdose reversal training video in a way that you can see it at home as well as here in the sanctuary. So if you would please give our tech team a round of applause. They've worked hard to make sure that today could be possible. I know many of us, maybe you were raised in a particular circumstance. Maybe this is the first time that you've heard about this issue. Maybe you have been immersed in this issue for decades and decades. Whatever your circumstance, I'm here to remind you that you can be a good Samaritan. It is so often easy to judge in our world rather than to be compassionate. And I think today is about opening our eyes to how we can be compassionate and how we can put ourselves more in the posture of being good Samaritans than walking by someone who may be having an issue. So today, we have some naloxone. I'm a little older, so we called it Narcan for a long time. So this is the brand Narcan naloxone. Today you have both the nasal device that you saw in the video as well as intramuscular injections. And again, there's a website and information about how you can receive these devices free to be able to help others and to get more information. But part of today's litany is a blessing of the naloxone written by Dr. Sharon Fenema. The liturgy will be on your screen, and I invite you to join with me at home. I'm placing it on my Bible because I think too often, especially if we're not really digging into these scriptures that can be enlightening as well as maddening, we forget that Jesus walked alongside so many people who were suffering and helped them find new life and resurrection. New life is before us. I invite you to extend your hands towards these kits as we offer this blessing. Creator of resurrection and life, we come to you with grateful hearts for all the ways your love continues to rise up in our midst. We give you thanks and praise for the holy drug naloxone and the new life that it can bring. We know that we need each other to survive. So we ask you to bless these kits and all those who will use them and all those who will be in need of them. Please join me. Make them and us instruments of resurrection, that suffering will be released, that injury will be transformed, that joy will arise, that strength will take hold, that hope will take wing, and that death will yield to new life. Empower us to live into our vocations as people of resurrection, bringers of new life, proclaimers in word and deed of a new day rising. In the name of all that unfurls hope in our midst every moment, we pray. Join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Come be with me. to survive.
Come to the last song of our worship service, and pre-COVID we would have the kids come down and play the percussion pit, and I miss that and can't wait for that to come back. But if you're at home, find some percussion. If you have your shakers or your bongos, or just get up and move around and clap your hands a bit.
Can you give some love online if you have not already for an amazing worship band and all that they have brought to us during this challenging time in our world? Can we give them a round of applause and give them some love? They work awfully hard to make sure that every week our music, as does our AB team, our music, our sermons, our worship, bring something home to you. And I know some of you are coming here in the sanctuary to experience the majesty of this space and to continue to find ways in which God is at work in your life. You know, we've blessed masks here in our sanctuary. We've blessed naloxone here in our sanctuary, and we also bless each of you as you go forth from here today. So I want to make a special point that next week, Hank is going to be preaching for us, so we're looking forward to that, because 150 years ago, these kind of sanctuaries were built for voices like Hank's, and we are so glad his time has come, and that folks who are really present in our LGBTQIA+ community are welcome in our pulpit here at St. John's, and not only welcome, but celebrated. So let's give Hank a little love online as well. Give him some courage for next week as he prepares to be in the pulpit again. And as you go forth from here today into the week ahead and into the Labor Day weekend, may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May God look upon you with kindness and give you peace while you go forth to live the gospel, resurrecting our suffering world in every way you can. Thanks be to God. Amen. Without it, life is
half the town. Cause suicides and ODs is laying them down. To the point that every day gets filled with sorrow. And got a feeling like, who we gonna lose tomorrow? A damn shame, cause they under the age of 30. This damn game is the reason we losing them early. But no one cares till it's one of their family and kids that being carried up, being sentenced to multiple years. And then the tears fall, but it's too late to cry now. Another youngster gone, another family crying out. The situation's sad, but all that's left for us to do is pray that God give them a pass, let them make it through.
I need y'all to pray with me. 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 I need y'all to pray with me.
I can only imagine how it feels and how it is to have to cry and say goodbye, bury both your kids. A couple of months apart, but still mended a broken heart. You forced to do it again and finish saving your life apart. God only knows what the reason and the next move. I pull my family closer so I could be the next dude. Cause you can never know when it be your time to go. But what we choose to know is we were born to die for show. So we must trust in God, especially when it's falling apart. Give him your heart, keep your faith and let him do his part. That got you through and show you what it is you need to do to get your back up off the wall and be the stronger you.
I need y'all to pray with me. 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 I need y'all to pray with me.
That's something I could do, but something I could truly say. That somebody preaching, need to practice what they preach and pray. Cause everybody is affected by this situation. Not just his wife and kids and members of his congregation. Like some of these folks in the street that live it every day. They're crying out for help, but don't be getting pushed away. Cause in the system here, it's all about the mathematics. And then you wonder why we back in jail to lose an addict. We on the verge of losing a generation and a whole town. Just look around and see who here, see who hit the ground. I know it's sad to say, but it also be so sad to me. You look to the sky, you tell my people rest in peace. Yeah, you look to the sky, you tell my people rest in peace. Yeah, you look to the sky, you tell my people rest in peace.
I need y'all to pray with me. 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 I need y'all to pray with me.